Hi, I'm Alejandro Solares, a PhD candidate at the University of Milan. I hold a bachelor degree in philosophy and a master degree in philosophy of science, both by the National Autonomous University of Mexico. I'm engaged in doing research in logic, philosophy of logic, and philosophy of information. Currently, I'm interested in informational approaches to logic, mainly for two reasons. First, they allow us to treat logical phenomena as activities performed by embodied, limited, and situated agents. Second, they have a fruitful interplay with computer science, cognitive science, game theory, and similar fields. Third, they are suitable for embracing non-classical logics and logical pluralism. Now, specifically, my research extends an informational approach introduced by Professor Marcello De Agostino and others. That approach departs from the fact that many interesting propositional logics are likely to be computationally intractable. So we cannot expect a real agent to be always able to recognize in practice that a certain conclusion follows from a given set of assumptions. This is a source of difficulties in fields such as AI, philosophy, and cognitive science that need less idealized yet theoretically principled models of rational agents with bounded cognitive and computational resources. The dead-bounded approach to classical propositional logic, put forward by De Agostino and others, provides an account of how this logic can be approximated in practice by real bounded agents via its reinterpretation in terms of an intuitive informational semantics. This approach leads to an infinite hierarchy of tractable approximations, which can be naturally related to the inferential power of agents. In my research, I'm extending such an approach by defining hierarchies of tractable dead-bounded approximations to some non-classical logics, namely, first-degree entailment, the logic of paradox, strong linear logic, and intuitionistic logic. With this, we pave the way for defining similar hierarchies for a variety of logics characterized by finite value matrices and Kripke-style semantics.
This is a crash tutorial on logics of formal inconsistency, LFAIs. It's part of a video series on non-classical logics. The goal of the tutorial is to provide a quite general introduction to the thrilling and extremely fruitful LFIs, which constitute a large family of paraconsistent logics. If I achieve my goal, you get interested in these logics and want to study them more deeply, you can check out the bibliography at the end of the video. Furthermore, in the series, you will find a video on the philosophical aspects and motivations for these logics, made by one of their proponents, João Marcos. For the sake of succinctness, and given that most interesting problems related to paraconsistency appear already at the propositional level, the tutorial will be restricted to that level. However, be aware that LFIs are extensible to first and higher order logics, and are powerful enough to reproduce all the main metatheoretical results of traditional logic, such as completeness, compactness, decidability, and so on. Furthermore, basic knowledge of classical logic will be assumed in this tutorial. The tutorial will be divided into parts. I'll start by giving some motivation for the content of the tutorial, and then give the basic notions to understand what an LFI is. In the second part, I'll first present what LFIs are somewhat informally, and then define them formally. Moreover, I'll give a concrete example of these logics and close the tutorial with some final remarks. Let us begin then. Perhaps the most counterintuitive property of classical logic and many other logics such as intuitionistic logic is that they allow the inference of any sentence from a single pair of contradictory sentences. Say, infer 2 plus 2 equals 5 from today is Monday and today is not Monday. This, of course, doesn't seem to be a rational inference. Traditional logic regards all contradictions as equally virulent. Once there is a pair of contradictory sentences, anything whatsoever follows. In other words, the consequence relation explodes into triviality. But should contradictions make it impossible to infer anything sensible when they appear? Or are there situations where they are tolerable, if only their wild behavior can be somehow controlled? Contradictions are presumably unavoidable in databases, scientific theories, philosophical argumentation, and so forth. In fact, contradictions aren't only frequent, but there are situations where reasonable inferences are made even in their presence. Consider, for example, the following situation. You ask two equally reliable friends of yours, does the party start at 8, Exactly one of the three following scenarios is possible. They might both say yes, they might both say no. One of them may say yes, while the other says no. In all scenarios, you can be sure whether the party starts at 8 or not, but only in the last one, where a contradiction appears, you are sure to have received wrong information from one of your sources. Now, our pragmatic starting point is not whether contradictory theories exist, but how to deal with them. Accordingly, the guiding criterion for choosing theories worthy of investigation should be their abstract character of non-triviality rather than the mere absence of contradictions. As we shall explain below, contradictions are problematic only when the principle of exclusion holds. A logical consequence relation is said to be paraconsistent if it is non-explosive and yet preserves enough properties to count as a logic, telling apart acceptable inferences from unacceptable ones. That is, it's not trivial. Now, let's translate these intuitions into formal definitions. The presentation will be situated at the level of the general theory of consequence relations. Now, the least we suppose on a logic is that its consequence relation satisfies the conditions defining what is known as a Tarskian consequence. Specifically, a single conclusion consequence relation satisfying reflexivity, monotonicity, and code for sets. I assume you are familiar with these three conditions, and you recall that this version of code is adequate for both finitary and infinitary consequence relations. So, with a logic, we shall mean a pair whose first element is a set of formulae called for and written in a signature containing a negative connective, a negation connective, and its second element is a Tarskian consequence relation over 4. Now, any subset gamma of 4 is called a theory. Gamma is said to be proper if it's distinct from 4, and gamma is said to be closed if it contains all of its consequences. Now, a theory gamma is contradictory if there is a sentence alpha such that gamma derives both alpha and its negation. Trivial if for any sentence alpha, gamma derives alpha. Explosive if it trivializes when exposed to a pair of contradictory sentences. From this, we can immediately conclude that, given reflexivity, 4 is trivial. That gamma is trivial implies that gamma is contradictory, but in general, not the other way around. By monotonicity, if gamma is trivial, then it's explosive. By code, if gamma is contradictory and explosive, then it's trivial. The above definitions may be immediately upgraded from theories to logics. Namely, a logic L is contradictory or trivial or explosive if and only if all of its theories are respectively contradictory or trivial or explosive. Now, we can give definitions for some logical principles as applied to a generic logic. The principle of non-contradiction demands a logic to be non-contradictory. The principle of non-triviality demands it to be non-trivial, and the principle of exclusion dictates it to be explosive. Logics failing non-contradiction are sometimes called dialectical, and the majority of paraconsistent logics in the literature, including LFAIs, are not so. Again, some immediate consequences are that a trivial logic is both contradictory and explosive, and an explosive logic fails non-triviality if and only if it fails non-contradiction. Now, what's a paraconsistent logic? To begin with, what's a consistent logic? In the literature, we find two different but classically equivalent notions of consistency. Given a deductive system with a negation connective, the system is consistent if and only if it is non-trivial, or the system is consistent if and only if it is not non-contradictory. Thus, a theory whose underlying logic is classical is contradictory if and only if it's trivial. But this is the case precisely because such a theory is explosive, since explosivity holds in classical logic. The obvious move to deal with contradiction is then to reject the unrestricted validity of explosion. This is a necessary condition if we want to have contradictory but non-trivial theorems. So, roughly, paraconsistency is the study of logical systems with a non-explosive negation, such that a pair alpha and not alpha doesn't always trivialize the system. The following definition can be extracted from the work of DaCosta. A paraconsistent logic is one that could accommodate for contradictory, yet not trivial, theories. Note that under this framework, paraconsistency has nothing to do with the rejection of non-contradiction. On the other hand, it is closely related to the rejection of explosion. Indeed, Jacobski defined a paraconsistent logic as a logic in which explosion fails. Using reflexivity and COT, it can be proven that the above definitions are equivalent. Now, a logic where all contradictions are equivalent cannot be paraconsistent. For validity of explosion follows easily from the assumption that all contradictions are equivalent. Thus, the very idea of paraconsistent logic implies that contradictions may have different meanings, which makes natural to have a device that distinguishes them. With this framework, we can define consistency in a different fashion. A logic is consistent if it is explosive and non-trivial, and the logic is inconsistent otherwise. Note that both paraconsistent and trivial logics are inconsistent. Paraconsistent logics are inconsistent in that they control explosivity in a variety of ways. Trivial logics are also inconsistent, but what distinguishes them from the former is that a trivial logic doesn't forbid any inference. Now, as a consequence of the above definition, we get a third definition of paraconsistency. A logic is paraconsistent if and only if it's inconsistent yet non-trivial. The compatibility of paraconsistency with the existence of some suitable explosive or trivial proper theories makes some paraconsistent logics able to recover classical reasoning, as the LFI is about to be described. LFIs were introduced by Carnelli and Marcos, extending and refining work of DaCosta. LFIs are the class of paraconsistent logics which can express the metanotions of consistency and inconsistency as operators independent of negation in their object language. The main idea underlying LFIs is that sentences should be divided into consistent and inconsistent. Contradictions are acceptable for the latter, but not for the former, in that consistent sentences are those for which explosion holds, while inconsistent sentences are those for which it doesn't. In turn, the intuition behind this division is that some contradictions are more hazardous than others. Say, a contradiction in a bank statement is unacceptable, but eventually expected in a weather forecast. Thus, consistent sentences behave classically. A theory which contains a pair of contradictory sentences alpha and not alpha explodes only if alpha or not alpha is taken to be consistent. This is the only distinction between LFIs and classical logic, however, with far-reaching consequences. Despite being deductive fragments of consistent logics, LFIs can be used to faithfully encode all consistent inferences. In fact, they are typically based on previously given consistent logic. For example, classical logic. The fundamental feature enjoyed by classical-based LFIs is being able to recover all consistent reasoning right on demand from inside a paraconsistent environment. This by, for example, defining a classical negation and so being able to do all classical reasoning using that negation. Or, as we shall roughly explain below, by reproducing classical reasoning by assuming a convenient number of sentences to be consistent. Now, if we understand consistency as what might be lacking to a contradiction for it to become explosive, LFIs are able to express the consistency of a formula in their object language. This feature allows consistent reasoning to be recovered from inside an inconsistent environment. More formally, consider a set of formulae ball P, which depends only on the propositional variable P, and a theory gamma. We say that gamma is ball gently explosive if there is something we can say about alpha, denoted by ball alpha, which is not enough if it is put together with alpha or put together with not alpha to trivialize. But if it is put together with both, that is, with a contradiction, it trivializes. Intuitively, Bol alpha stands for a set of schematic unary formulas expressing the consistency of alpha. In turn, we say that a logic is gently explosive if all its theories are Bol gently explosive with respect to the same Bol p of the above definition. Thus, there is another way of controlling explosion, namely, the gentle principle of explosion dictating a logic to be Bol gently explosive. Again, for any alpha, Bol alpha is intended to express the consistency of alpha relative to a logic. When Bol alpha is a singleton, we denote by small Bol alpha the solved element of it. In that case, small Bol defines an unary consistency connective. This connective isn't necessarily primitive, for some LFIs present it as defined in terms of other connectives. Now, a logic of formal inconsistency is any Bol gently explosive but inconsistent logic. That is, any logic where explosion fails while gentle explosion holds. So, LFIs are able to express at the object language when we can trust explosion to occur. They reject explosion in the presence of a contradiction unless one of the contradictory sentences is taken to be consistent. In turn, intuitively, we can understand the notion of a consistent contradiction as a contradiction involving sentences that count on conclusive evidence. Now, according to our third definition of paraconsistent logics above, these are non-trivial logics whose negation fails the consistency presupposition. Some inferences that depend on this presupposition will be then necessarily lost. However, we might expect that if a sufficient number of consistency assumptions are made, then those same inferences should be recovered. LFIs are aimed to be exactly that, the logics that can internalize this idea. Let's make this more precise. Consider a logic L1 in which explosion holds for a negation connective. Consider some other logic L2 written in the same signature as L1, such that L2 is a proper deductive fragment of L1, which validates inferences of L1 only if they are compatible with the failure of explosion. L2 is expressive enough so as to be an LFI. L1 can actually be recovered from L2 by the addition of Bol alpha as a new set of valid schemas or actions. These constraints suggest that the reasoning of L1 might somehow be recovered from inside L2, if only a sufficient number of consistency assumptions are added in each case. Thereby, typically, the following derivability adjustment theorem may be proven. We have two logics, L1 and L2, L2 weaker than L1, and such that we can reproduce inside it the reasoning we can do in the stronger one, where Bol delta stands for a number of consistency assumptions that we will have to include among the premises to be able to reproduce in the weaker logic what the stronger logic can do. So in particular, the theorem describes how LFIs can recover consistent inferences via convenient derivability adjustments. Let us now give a concrete example of an LFI. We start by introducing the concept of C-system. Consider two logics, L1 and L2, respectively defined over signatures sigma 1 and sigma 2, such that sigma 2 extends sigma 1 and sigma 2 contains a negation that doesn't belong to sigma 1. Then L2 is a C-system based on L1 with respect to the negation connective if and only if L2 is a conservative extension of L1, L2 is an LFI, such that consistency may be defined as a unary connective. The non-explosive negation cannot be defined in L1, and L1 is non-trivial. The well-known logic CN introduced by Da Costa provide examples of C systems based on classical logic, provided that each CN is presented in an extended signature including classical negation. Now, the following is the most basic CN logic. For every alpha, Let small bold alpha be an abbreviation of it's not the case that alpha and not alpha, which makes the consistency of a sentence alpha equivalent to saying that it is not contradictory. The logic C1 may be axiomatized by the following schemas, where the last four schemas govern the consistency connective. BC1 realizes in a finitary way the gentle explosion, telling us that the explosion is restricted to consistent formulae. For their part, CA1 to CA3 tell us how consistency propagates through binary connectives. Schemas 1 to 9 plus modexponents axiomatize what is known as positive classical logic, that is, classical logic without negation. Negation shows up in schemas 10 and 11, respectively telling us that excluded middle as well as double negation elimination holds for this paraconsistent negation. Again, in C1, the set bold P is a singleton, defining a consistency connective which is equivalent to a formula expressing that P is non-contradictory. However, the schemas governing the consistency connective in C1 can be stated differently by taking a small ball as a primitive connective instead of an abbreviation. These new axioms yield different logics. Thus, as any paraconsistent logic, LFIs distinguish triviality from inconsistency. But additionally, given that the small ball alpha may be primitive and not equivalent to the formula expressing that alpha is non-contradictory, LFIs are able to distinguish inconsistency from contradiction. Once that equivalence is broken, very interesting new venues arise. For example, a small bold alpha may express other notions of consistency not necessarily related to freedom from contradiction. Moreover, in C1, we can define a classical negation, and so C1 may be rewritten in an extended signature which contains that negation as primitive. So it is easy to see that C1 is based on classical logic. And this is only the tip of the iceberg. For instance, there are more expressive LFIs endowed with a dual inconsistency connective. And besides the derivability adjustment theorem, there are other more direct ways of recovering consistent reasoning from inside a given LFI. Here you have essential bibliography on LFIs, where the topics we approach, and many more, are extensively studied. And again, for the philosophical aspects and motivations of LFIs, watch the video by João Marcos in this series. Thanks for watching. See you next time.